Hello everybody, this is another AEM webinar. My name is Thomas Lothheisen from Tübingen in Germany.
And my name is Rüdiger Eichholz from Stuttgart.
Our third colleague, Wolf Armbruster, he can join us today.
What are we looking at today? We will present you a structured examination for what we call the extended FAST examination, which is an examination for an ultrasound use in the emergency room or on the intensive care unit.
Yeah, this is very much according to the ATLS criteria. Important for us is that we want to diagnose first what kills first, and this leads to immediate treatment of factors that might kill the patient.
Okay, let's have a look on the on this slide where we have put down the probe positions. So we've got 8 different probe positions and we've got clinical questions. We will come back to this slide later on as a summary. Important is that looking at these 8 positions, we first look at the subcostal view for looking for a 4-chamber view of the heart for pericardial effusion. And then how about the next 2 probe positions, Thomas?
Yeah, we have the pleural positions, which is just beside the sternum on the right side and also on the left side. This is good for exclusion of pneumothorax.
And then we've got 5 further probe positions, and it may be a little bit confusing because we've got 8 positions in total, and then we've got also 5 FAST positions. And this, at the end, comes from the older FAST examination course, where we only had these 5 positions. But now, as extended FAST examinations, we have 8. And the 5 FAST positions at the end look for free fluid in the chest and in the abdomen.
It might be somehow confusing if you see all these probe positions in this overview, but we developed some steps in order to make clear how to find the positions
and the right scanning window. So step 1 is we look for the pericardial effusion and we try to rule out pneumothorax. How does it work?
Now this is a typical situation in emergency room, and now we start to approach our probe in subcostal position. Now we tilt the probe and we try to find a good view in order to diagnose the heart. And this is the ultrasound picture or the movie, and this is the hypoechoic region of the heart. And yeah, so here we can exclude any effusion.
The second and the third position you can see here. So we try to make sure on the left side that we do not only see the heart. So we see, we have a look on the right side on the ultrasound movie here, and also use the M mode, the motion mode for a typical seashore sign. Change to the other side, we see a little bit of the heart here, which is also seen in the M mode in this example. So it is important to look at these 3 positions first, because imagine you would have a pericardial tamponade, you would have to treat this very, very rapidly because it can kill the patient rapidly. And if not, you move on to pneumothorax. And in case of tension pneumothorax, you have to solve this problem before you proceed with your examination course. How do we proceed, Thomas?
Okay, the next step, step 2, is good for diagnosis or exclusion of pleural effusion or hemothorax, and also good for diagnosis or exclusion for free fluid in the upper abdomen on the right side.
Let's have a look on this dummy patient again. So the probe flies in, goes into the axillary region in the mid-axillary line, and then we slide it down until we see the first organ, which is the liver, and then we rotate the probe in order to have a good view through the rib cage. And then we move on the probe further caudally to the kidney and try to image the kidney, especially the lower part of it. and we look for what we call the Morris's pouch,
which is the space between the kidney and the liver.
Now we see the same thing in an ultrasound video. Have a look on the liver and the very hyperechoic diaphragm, or the pleura on the diaphragm here, and we see the movement with inspiration. And then we move on further caudally to the kidney, try to get the kidney right into the middle of our ultrasound screen and scan the posterior and anterior part of it.
Okay, now we move the probe on the other side, on the left side, and to step three, we want to diagnose or exclude pleural effusion and hemothorax, and also diagnose or exclude free fluid of the upper abdomen on the left side.
So at the end, it's basically the same thing like on the right side, apart from that the probe position is further posteriorly, because the spleen is located pretty much on the posterior side and relatively far up in the abdomen. So we slide the probe caudally in the posterior axillary line until we see the first organ, which is then obviously the spleen, and then we tilt the probe to have a good view without rib shadows, and then we tilt back parallel to the patient bed and try to visualize the kidney.
Okay. Now this is the ultrasound clip. What we see is a lot of ribs here, and now there's a small gap and we can get the spleen in this clip, and what we see also is the pleura on the diaphragm, and we can exclude hemothorax because there's no hyperechoic area on top of the diaphragm. Now we move the probe further caudally.
And this is already finished right now, but you've probably seen that there was no fluid in Koller's pouch, basically, and what you see at the moment is also a little bit of gas in the intestines. So I think we can move on to the next step.
So step four is good for diagnosis or exclude free fluid in the lesser pelvis. And now we'll have a look on how it works. We put the probe on the
lower abdomen.
In the lower abdomen, and now we'll see the bladder, hopefully. And we rotate the probe again, so we have two axes in order to get a good impression of the situation, especially in order to identify free fluid. And this is the hyperechoic space here, is the bladder. And now we rotate again, and there's no hyperechoic space or area
out of the bladder,
which is very important.
So let's have a look on the entire examination course again. So just keep in mind that the order of the probe positions is ATLS based. Diagnose first, what kills first. So we move the probe in the subcostal position, tilt it upwards from the inferior cava vein towards the right atrium. We see the same thing now. So we've got the diaphragm, the liver, and the cava vein. And now we've got the four chamber view, and we look around the heart whether there is an hypoechoic zone all around as pericardial effusion, which was obviously not the case. Now we move on to the two pleural probe positions, the right one and now the left one, and look for the lung sliding. Use also M-mode, which is not shown here, and this is the left side, also the heart is part of this video right now. And now
we move to the FAST 1 position. It's the space between the lung and the diaphragm. Just by putting the probe in the mid-axillary line, we slide caudally, and if we find the liver, we rotate the probe in order to get a good view through the ribs. We rotate back, slide more caudally, we identify the Morrison pouch, we tilt in order to identify the kidney or the space between kidney and liver, the Morrison pouch, and this is the video clip. So now here you identify the liver, optimize the picture, and there's no free fluid above the diaphragm.
Next step is to have a look on Morrison's pouch, and we've seen the kidney right here, and all around the kidney there is also no hypoechoic zone, so there is no free fluid. And on the other side, again, use the posterior axillary line and slide cordally slowly until you see the first organ, and rotate the probe in order to avoid rib shadows and have a good view on the diaphragm, on the spleen, and rule out for fluid in the left chest. And then we move on to the kidney for Kollers pouch.
And finally, the next step
will be shown in a second. So we've got the ultrasound clip first. So we slide cordially from the axilla and see that there is an organ, which is the spleen. Rotate the probe to avoid rib shadows. See the diaphragm. See occasionally with inspiration what we call the dirty curtain coming in under the probe, which is lung filled with air. So whenever you see this, there can't be any free fluid. And then you see the kidney, and there is also no free fluid all around the kidney. So no free fluid in Kollers pouch.
Now we proceed to the next step. We put the probe on the lower abdomen and tilt it in the lesser pelvis like this. We rotate and like this we can exclude or diagnose free fluid in lesser pelvis.
And then the examination course is nearly finished. We've got the ultrasound clip here of the bladder and in the two different axes. And at the end, once you're experienced in doing this examination course, it only takes 2 minutes or even less than that, especially if you rule out pathological findings. So we've seen normal findings until now, and now we look at some abnormalities. So what you see here is the diaphragm and the liver, and in the chest you see a fluid collection. So this is a hypoechogenic zone on the image, which is at the end, a pleural effusion on the right side, and this is FAST 1 position.
So we can identify if it's blood or chest pleural effusion, but like this we can at least diagnose that this is wrong. And if we consider that most of our patients are traumatized patients, it's very likely that it is blood in emergency room situations.
Now we've just seen another pathology on the same side, slightly further cordially. So you can see here part of the diaphragm, you can see part of the liver and the kidney. And you see this hypoechogenic triangle between the kidney and the liver, which is, of course, Morrison's pouch, and there is free fluid in Morrison's pouch. So FAST 2 position, free fluid in Morrison's pouch in this on this video clip. What else do we have?
Okay, so here we can see the heart in the subcostal view, and which is very clear is that there's a small hypoechoic stripe around the heart wall, and this of course is pericardial effusion, and this has to be treated immediately, of course.
It to be honest, it depends on whether it is a pericardial tamponade or not, and so immediate action to save the patient's life has to be taken once it is a pericardial tamponade. In this case, it is not yet, but of course it could get to this point. So no evidence for cardiac tamponade in this case.
So next finding is on this FAST 5 position. Here we can see the bladder, but under the bladder there are some asymmetric hypoechoic areas, and this is a typical finding for free fluid in the lesser pelvis?
Okay, summary in words, and now let's get back to the very beginning, where we had the propositions and the clinical question. So we hope, after having demonstrated the examination course and some abnormal findings, that this makes it clearer to you what is meant with this structured extended fast examination. And we strongly recommend to use a very structured and standardized course of examination in every patient, and also for all the different disciplines, to have really reliable video clips and pictures and in a very, very limited, stressful period of time, a good idea on what the patient's problem is.
So thanks for watching our webinar. Hope to see you again and have fun with using ultrasound.
Thank you. Bye-bye.